And this is where it all happens. I'm actually on the set of the film. We're trying to film a very difficult shot with Drooler, one of the dogs.
Shake, stay. Mark, shake, stay.
In this scene, Drooler is at one end of a tug of war. At the other end is the character Kevin, played by Johan Gruffydd. And Drooler was kind enough to help him out at rehearsals.
Stay. That's it. Stay. Hold it. Good. Okay, good.
Drooler's trademark drool is made of long plastic strips that are trimmed to length, and whipped up egg white is brushed on to make him look really authentic. What a great set, isn't it? The story is that the fella is an ex-sculptor, the fella that's running this dog refuge. And all the dogs live in this wonderful, wonderful hodgepodge of bulbs of sculpture made out of all sorts of things.
When the press sees what you're doing to these poor dogs, you'll be the most hated man in London.
Another star of the film is a macaw who plays Mr. Waddlesworth. Trainer Dave Souza has worked closely with his pet, who is actually a female called Britain.
You know, in the beginning, she didn't understand anything about the filming business, but now she waits for the camera to come up and she looks for the camera. So it's pretty neat, yeah, because she sees her reflection in the lenses and stuff, so she really likes it. Good, wings. Wings. I know, wings. Wings. No, stay. Wings. Good. Very nice. Good.
Although the film features big names like Glenn Close and Gerard Depardieu, the real stars are the animals. And I can't wait to see these little fellas on the big screen. Well, we'll just have to wait till next Christmas for that film to be released. What a well-trained bird Mr. Waddlesworth was. And that's not easy to say. A very well-behaved cockatiel called Sing Sing was brought in by its owner Les to see vet Sarah Opie last week. Les was worried that he might have injured the bird.
I accidentally stepped on her because she follows me all over the place.
She's got rather strange feet already, isn't she?
Yeah, somebody did that to her when she was really young, so I thought it's better than them putting her down, you know, to go to a good home, so...
You think somebody did that on purpose with the feet, or
I think
it was just a deformed foot?
I think she was left outside when she was very young, and she probably got frostbitten, you know, on the feet or something that. You can see she's very affectionate.
Yeah.
Because I think injured animals, they know when you're looking after them.
Thank you,
sir. She'll settle down in a minute. She'll probably land on somebody's head in a minute, or shoulder.
That'll do it.
Which leg do you think you stood on, then?
On the left leg, which is this one here. And she was really hobbling about badly on Friday night. Yeah, of course you can. And I was worried that it was actually the top of the leg, you know, the actual joint, which could have been pulled out of line.
Come here. That's pretty good.
I would say she's favouring her left leg a little bit.
Yeah.
But it's moving all right. It's certainly not swinging in the breeze, so you definitely haven't broken it.
Okay.
I mean, if you did step on it, then you've probably bruised it a bit, but I wouldn't worry about it.
Do you know how to make good bird sounds to go with that? Hold your two fingers together and suck air through it like this.
Oh, what was that?
She likes people talking to her.
Yeah. Mm. No, she looks really healthy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't worry. I don't think you've done any damage. She's a tame cockatoo, goodness.
She's lovely.
That Sing Sing was a lovely cockatiel. Now, through the series, we've shown you cats stuck in extraordinary places, up trees waiting for the fire brigade to rescue them, stuck between walls, even down a chimney. But what we didn't expect to see was a dog 60 foot up in the air on an exposed balcony. Krista Hart joined Inspector Becky Wadey at the scene. Becky was very worried about the dog and needed to move fast.
What he's doing is walking around the edge. Okay. I mean, you must be aware he's doing that.
The owner was aware of the dangers for her dog, but she just didn't know what to do. It kept jumping up onto the wall. She'd recently moved from a house with a garden into a small flat, with only the balcony to exercise the dog.
Normally, you don't have that sort of balcony where they've got a wall, they can walk right around the edge, and normally kind of railings. I've told her that she ought to have more fencing there just to stop the dog slipping over the edge. It's, as you've seen, it's very dangerous for the dog. And I've told her, she's calling it.
The owner then called us back upstairs. After Becky had pointed out to her how unsafe the balcony was, she felt there was only one thing she could do. Give up her dog, Merlin.
It's the right decision, isn't it? It is, yes, it is. I mean, as you saw, it's a small flat. I think with two bedrooms, very cramped. And he's a very large, young, boisterous dog. I certainly wouldn't be able to cope with him.
Becky took Merlin down to the rehoming centre in South Godston, where care assistant Sarah Jupp was waiting to have a look at him.
Hi there.
Hi, Becky.
Okay.
Hello.
Hi.
This is Merlin.
Hi, Merlin.
Signed him over.
I was going to check him over. Some nice bright eyes.
Seems to have right a few mats every behind his ears.
Oh, right.
Back of his legs, but other than that.
Good lad.
He's a little bit underweight.
He's a little bit. He's obviously not great concern, but hopefully he'll start to pick up a little bit of weight. There's a good lad. And then what we'll do once he's had a day or two to settle in, we'll give him a vaccination, worming and flea control him.
How long do you think it will be before he's rehomed?
It won't take very long for him to get a home, but unfortunately at the moment we are closed over Christmas. But in the new year, he'll go up for rehoming, and I'm sure we won't have a problem getting him a new home. He seems like a lovely boy.
Yeah. He's great.
Good luck to Merlin. Don't forget the rehoming centres are closed now until the new year, so if you want to rehome him or any other dogs, you'll have to wait until they open again. Since the series started way back in October, we've featured some lovely dogs who've come out of some terrible situations. But some of them have already been lucky enough to find good and loving homes. We thought we'd bring you up to date with some of our waifs and strays. Do you remember Dallas? He'd been found wandering on Barnes Common in a very sorry state.
Very bony, very ribby. And he's had this horrendous skin problem.
But look at him now. His fur's growing
good
back
boy.
And he's wonderfully happy living with John and Wendy.
Just needs someone to be there for him, to look after him and show him a bit of affection. I don't think he had much of it before.
He's been absolutely wonderful. How anyone could have treated a big soft mutt like this, I got a clue.
We also featured two Jack Russell pups, one of which had a broken leg.
Well, these guys were seen by a member of the public, apparently being thrown out of a transit van.
Alfie is now enjoying happier times, his leg well on the mend. He lives with David and Julia.
3 weeks he's been with us, but he's just so well behaved. He's a cracking little dog, he really is.
He's come here and he's taken a place in our hearts and we love him to bits.
And his brother Tommy is a bundle of energy, living with Carol and Sally.
We went to Battersea and said that we wanted a small puppy. They produced this one and he just fitted the bill. He's wonderful.
And how about that lurcher mum and her pups that had been left abandoned in a car park? She was so thin and weak.
Oh, you're in a bit of a mess, aren't you? Oh dear.
Rosie, the mother, now has a new home with the Johnston family. And as for the pups, one has just been rehomed and the others, Finbar, Shauna and little Seamus, are healthy and waiting to go. And finally, there was the sad story of Spike, who was very loved but had become just too much of a handful for his owner.
He's very loving.
He's lovely, isn't he?
Oh, he likes custard creams. His favourite.
But now Spike has a very bright and rosy future with Dave and Julie.
He's everything we wanted and more. He is giving us so much love and he's just putting all of his trust in us and we're not going to let him down.
Isn't it lovely to see them all so settled in with their new owners? Over the years on this program, we've seen many different animals bond with humans. Just before Christmas, Krista Hart braved the weather in the Scottish Highlands to meet Tilly Smith, who looks after the UK's only herd of reindeer. Krista found that Tilly has a unique way of communicating with them.
Heavy. Do you call them up? Yes, I'll give him a call, a bit like Grubs Up Now, boys.
Go on, then.
No! Come on, no! Go, boys. Stop. Come on, no.
Beautiful.
Good. They'll come right up to us. Reindeer are incredibly friendly animals, and they'll be all around us, and we'll be able to feed them.
First to reach us was a two-year-old male called Pepsi.
Pepsi's getting a bit hungry.
He certainly
is. Can we feed one of them?
We certainly can feed them. They're lovely to hand feed reindeer. Reindeer have got completely furry noses, so you can take your gloves off because they'll just tickle your hands.
Oh,
there we go. And you've got biscuit feeding with you as well there.
It does tickle, doesn't it?
It does tickle, yep.
Have they got very different characters, each of them?
They certainly have. Pepsi is very bold. He's got a mum who is very, very friendly, and he came up as a calf and learnt all the friendliness. Some of them are more standoffish and hold back. We've got a big boy coming up here. This is Crackle. He's actually already broken one of his antlers off for this year.
So what happens if once they're broken, that's it, they don't go back?
For this year, no, but the whole lot's going to fall off. So every year the reindeer replace the antlers on
them. Every single one of them grows a new set?
That's right.
Male and female?
Male and female, yeah.
How incredible. Presumably it gets really cold here. How do they cope?
Well, reindeer are covered in hair from tip to toe. And in the winter time, their coats are fantastically thick. They say that it's 2,000 hairs to a square centimetre. And on top of that, each hair is hollow. So it's like an enormous duvet wrapped around them. And when they lie down in the snow, they don't let any of the heat out. It doesn't even melt the snow they're lying on, so it's a nice warm bed, a bed of snow for a reindeer.
You are gorgeous. So these ones in this area are all male, are they?
They are, yes. These are all males, and these are the chaps that we use at Christmas time. We can train them very easily to harness. Reindeer are a domesticated animal. And the important thing about a reindeer is it's a very strongly herding animal. And if you go away with a group of reindeer, they feed off each other's confidence, and more importantly, they feed off you as the handler, because they see us as part of the herd. So if we're walking quietly along, they'll walk quietly along behind us.
Now it was time for Santa's special reindeer to go down the mountain.
Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer had a very shiny nose.
Good boy, come on now.
Stop. You would even say it glows. All of the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names. They never let poor Rudy join in any reindeer game. Rudolph.
Unless it's Christmas Eve, the reindeer travel in a specially converted lorry.
Now, I noticed when we were walking along that there's a funny clicking noise. What is that?
When the reindeer walk, there's a tendon that slips across the joint just above the foot, and it goes click. Now, this is a way of them listening out for each other. They can hear each other. It means they can stay together in a blizzard. If they can't see each other, they can at least hear each other.
Where will these ones be going?
They go all over the country, to be absolutely honest, but the next port of call is Windsor.
When do they meet up with Santa?
Well, Santa doesn't like getting his hands dirty, so we meet Santa there.
Typical.
Right, so that's ready to go.
Great.
Fascinating information from Tilly, and what beautiful creatures they are. We'll be seeing them again before the end of the program. 2,000 hairs in a square centimetre. Amazing. A little dog brought into Tessa's clinic this week could have done with some of their fur. He had to wear extra layers in this cold weather.
And what's the problem with Benji?
About 4 or 5 days ago, he stopped eating, basically. Keeps being sick. He's ate a bit of food, but he keeps basically bringing it back up again.
Mm-hmm.
So we're a bit worried about what's happening to him, you know? Mm-hmm. Let's take this off.
Let me slip his... There you go.
He's bald.
He's very bald.
Is it Chihuahua?
No, it's a Mexican hairless.
Good boy.
He's a good dog, yes.
Good
yes.
Good boy, I'm sorry.
Just got to get your temperature.
Cheeky, that, isn't it? Where did he come from?
We rescued him from a house. He was being ill-treated, basically. There was quite a lot of them.
Oh,
and
right.
We took care of 3 of them.
Oh.
They've all got good homes now, though, you know?
Oh, right, so the others went to other homes,
yeah,
today.
Yeah, they're all being looked after very well.
Mm, his temperature's okay.
Yeah.
So that's good.
he's not dehydrated or anything, and his stomach's not sore when I'm, you know, he's let me have a really good feel, make sure there's no lumps or bumps or anything. So I think it's more of a gastritis, an infection that he's picked up. Mm. Doesn't look like it's an acute problem, and there's no sign that he's got an obstruction, which is the big worry with vomiting, is that he may have eaten something.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to give him a long-acting injection.
Okay.
With something to stop him feeling sick.
Beautiful. You put that on him?
Yeah.
He feels a cold badly.
Yeah, he shivers. He shivers like a naked man in the rain.
It is bad when you're naked out in the rain, isn't it? It's not all that good. I should imagine.
Not that I've ever done it, but.
And you knit the coats, do you?
No, you bought them. Bought the coats from
outside. Purchase the coats.
Purchase the coats. My knitting's not too good, unfortunately.
Do you have different coloured coats for the different ones?
Yeah. He's got about three different coloured coats.
He's got his Christmassy one.
He's got his Christmassy one, he's got his posing one, which is kind of, it's a bit more low cut, so it shows a bit more leg.
Can you just hold on to his head?
Sorry, I put all these clothes back on again. I forgot we're doing this.
You can still work around it. Oh, it's more like injecting a person, this, isn't it, little bear skin?
Good boy.
If he's still being sick, then we need to see him back tomorrow or the next day.
Okay.
If he's feeling a bit better, then just keep him on the light food, so boiled fish or chicken, for a couple of days and then see how he goes.
Okay, then.
Do you think you're quite relieved to find there's nothing seriously wrong?
Yeah, very relieved. He's very well loved. Very well loved.
You can just tell he's well loved, can't you? But sadly, that's not always the case. Remember this?
Oh, poor dog.
Do you want me to lift her up on the
table?
The lurcher that was brought into the hospital.
Oh, my goodness. Here we go. I don't think I've ever seen mange as so infected and raw and painful as this.
She'd been badly neglected by her previous owner and was in a critical condition. It's been a long haul, but Millie, as she's been named by the nurses, has been making good progress. Tessa prescribed antibiotics for Millie, and apart from feeding her up, the most important thing to do was to treat that terrible mange. Under the microscope, dozens of mites showed up clearly, confirming Tessa's diagnosis of sarcoptic mange. A couple of days later, she was having her second mange wash to soothe the irritation and to kill the mites.
Her skin was very inflamed when she first came in, very, very sore. And with the combination of antibiotics and the mange mite washes, it seems to be much better. She's actually put on nearly a kilo in weight, so she's doing really well. We're really pleased with her. She's not too keen on other dogs, but she's very friendly with the nurses. I think once she's got over this, I think she'll find a nice home somewhere.
Millie came into the hospital just 16 days ago.
I'm a little lamb who's lost in the wood. I know I could always be good to one who'll watch over me.
Doesn't she look fantastic? And she's got great character too. She'll be ready for a new home in the new year. Come on, Mill. Let's hope she gets a good one. She certainly deserves it. Well, that's all we've got time for this millennium. We'll see you in the 21st century. In the spring, we'll be back and the program will be coming to you from Manchester. In the meantime, from all of us here at Animal Hospital in Putney, Happy New Year!
One of the greatest stories ever told, Charles Dickens' David Copperfield, concludes next tonight on BBC One.
Thank you. This is your mission, should you choose to accept it.
We're being ambushed before us. That's an order.
They knew we were coming. Will you read me?
I want to know why he did it.
These guys are trained to be ghosts. Find something that's personally important to him and you squeeze.
Tom Cruise.
I can understand you're very upset.
You've never seen me very upset.
Mission Possible, tonight at 9 on BBC One.
This tape will self-destruct in 5 seconds.
The tensions of life confined in a German U-boat on BBC Two now, in the acclaimed drama The Boat. Here on BBC One, Max is playing Santa until he finds himself stuck in a lift with Tina. How will they pass the time? Christmas Casualty at 8 o'clock.
I am Mrs. Bradley.
Driver wanted.
I see an older woman in your life.
Must be intelligent.
George, I need your body.
Loyal.
George stays where I stay. Very.
Charming.
Bravo, George.
And peculiarly fond of dead bodies.
I should have thought that was fairly obvious, George.
Thoroughly Modern Murder. Diana Rigg is Mrs. Bradley.
A real pleasure.
New drama, coming in January to BBC One.
Now on BBC One, The Journey of a Lifetime continues.
How is she?
Who's she?